Following the breakdown of the truce, the Provisionals launched their biggest military offensive to date. The commercial centres of Derry, Belfast and other major towns began to look as if they had been blitzed from the air. In the space of a few days, British investment was hit with millions of pounds of losses. And because of warnings, there were virtually no civilian casualties. Until July 21st, when bombs placed in Belfast killed 9 civilians. The British government and media seized the opportunity given by Bloody Friday, as it was to be called, to present the IRA as mad terrorists. It was only several months later that an investigation by the London Sunday Times revealed that hour-long warnings for all the bombs had been given to the Samaritan organization, which had in turn notified the police. For some reason, however, several of the bomb alerts were not passed on by the police to the target areas. The result was several innocent people killed and injured, and a tremendous propaganda victory for the British government.
A lot of people assumed that this distortion was bad journalism, when in fact that was not accurate. For this distortion was a deliberate tactic within the context of Frank Kitson's theory of counterinsurgency, because Kitson has recognized the important role that the media has to play in a counterinsurgency campaign, and has always strived to use the media as a platform where necessary to distort the image of the Republican Army as a liberation movement, and to project this image of the British occupation forces as some kind of police service.
Ten days after Bloody Friday, 22,000 British troops occupied the Nationalist ghettos in a move codenamed Operation Motorman. It was the end of Free Derry and Free Belfast.
Let Eric see, there's the power.
There's the power there.
What chance have I against a man like that?
The cream of the British Army, paratroopers.
A couple of thousand came over them house last night and cut us their ribbons. They didn't give us a chance.
Arrange a meeting with Jack Lynch and
it's a blarney.
That's a lot of bloody hooey.
Yankee blarney.
We're dying up here. We're getting murdered up here. Murdered.
I have made it perfectly clear that these operations are designed to protect the whole community, to remove the fear of intimidation by terrorists from the community, from whatever it may come. And I think that after the work of Her Majesty's government over these recent months, the patience of Her Majesty's government, the work to convince the minority community that we are determined to give them a fair deal, I trust this friction will not arise. I see no reason why it should. The security forces are there to protect the whole community.
There are over 1,000 different British firms throughout Ireland, north and south, controlling more than 60% of the country's total industrial activity. One week after Operation Motorman, moderate nationalist politicians were having talks with William Whitelaw. In order to pacify the nationalists, the British government was willing to force concessions from the unionists. Finally, in January 1974, a power-sharing government was formed, in which moderate nationalists were given certain cabinet positions. It was a Northern Ireland first, also a last. The problem was that after 300 years of ascendancy, the loyalist people would only support a government that could guarantee their privileges. Power sharing with the nationalists was unthinkable. On May 14, 1974, loyalist extremist groups controlling workers in the key electric generating plants launched a strike against the new government. When the British Army refused to intervene, the success of the strike was assured. Within 2 weeks, the power-sharing government fell. Britain had been caught in the contradiction of trying to reform a state that was simply irreformable. It could only be consolidated by the physical crushing of the nationalist resistance. The other solution, the only possible one for the nationalists, remained the destruction of the Northern Ireland state itself. The struggle in the north had passed the point of no return.
To protest against internment, and despite the ban on parades, we have decided that we will parade tomorrow through the streets of Derry.
This is Turf Lodge, a housing estate in West Belfast. It's a nationalist district like most others, which means an unemployment rate of over 20%. It also means a military occupation, endless raids and arrests, and the constant threat of violent death.